A depression kid, he danced for coins in Times Square, sold wristwatches he had won in the ring, and worked odd jobs from the time he was seven. He never did drugs, he never stole, and wasn't a drinker. A minor miracle in the carnival world of mobsters, promoters, bottle blondes, and sports writers. Though his ride was bumpy, Sugar Ray called the shots and took the hits.
Ray Robson had his own style. Nobody could copy it.
Sugar Ray had one of the quickest left hooks in the business.
Pow! One of those things you go, whoa, where did that come from? That was Sugar Ray, and when he got you in trouble, curtains.
Great chin and enormous courage. You were in terrible trouble if Robinson was on one knee looking at you. As he always got up.
Even though he was taking consciousness from the other person, the manner in which he did it left you breathless. There was a mystery to it.
He was a wizard in the ring. His hands moved like lightning. He was like a gazelle. It was like watching a ballet. You would never know the other guy was in the ring when he was there.
He had these fights that were all Hollywood script. That just added to the legend of who he was.
In Chicago Stadium on Valentine's Day 1951, Robinson challenged his old nemesis Jake LaMotta for the middleweight championship of the world. This was the finale, fight number six in a classic saga between brawler and boxer.
LaMotta was the only man to beat him in his first 123 fights. 123 fights? I mean, fighters today don't even have 123 fights.
Robinson knew that LaMotta was having trouble making weight. And his strategy going into the fight was to make LaMotta work, to tire himself out in the early rounds.
Any questions? Shake hands and come out fighting.
Every time the referee breaks him, he backs off so far that Jake has to waddle after him. All he's going to do is take the legs out from under Jake, and that'll be it.
By the 10th round, LaMotta was out of gas. LaMotta makes a last desperate stand. He bowls Robinson into a corner. He throws everything he's got at Robinson. And then Robinson comes out of the corner blazing, and the fight turns right there.
He threw a left hook, right hand, left hook, that so fast that it was like one punch.
No man could endure this punch.
Ray was unleashing everything on him. He only missed a few punches.
LaMotta at this moment, a tired battler, a stopping block.
Robinson out-strategized LaMotta, then beat him up.
The referee stopped the fight in the 13th round while I was still on my feet with Robinson pounding me up against the ropes. If the referee held up another 30 seconds, Robinson would have collapsed from hitting me.
Never went down, Ray. You never got me down, Ray.
You could knock me down, Ray. You could knock me down.
As middleweight champ, Sugar Ray's physical appeal and natural charm helped him transcend deep racial divides. Soon his image could be found on all things American.
The new middleweight champion of the world, Sugar Ray Robinson.
Robinson was the best loved athlete, I think, of his time. Everybody loved Ray Robinson. Even the people who hated blacks loved him. They couldn't help loving him.
Remember one night in a little town in South Dakota, we were standing in the kitchen doorway watching him fight, and my mother was so excited I didn't think we could settle her down.
When I think of him, I think of the first hip sports hero. He had the hottest club in New York City, Sugar Ray's Cafe in Harlem. His friends were the hippest people, Frank Sinatra, Jackie Gleason, Joe DiMaggio.
Ray had half a block there on the west side, south of 125th Street, where he had his real estate office, his wife's beauty parlor, and his own barber shop, dry cleaners. He was a prominent Harlem citizen.
He had a Cadillac, pink, but I mean genuine pink. The most beautiful thing you ever saw.
I never met a woman that wasn't attracted to him. You know, I mean, it's just amazing.
Absolutely amazing.
He was gorgeous. The man was cute all the way. He looks like a chocolate baby bunny. You know, you'd like to bite him. He looks so good.
Women did run behind him, and he accepted them and would do things to make them come. He was a little devil.
The first time Robinson got in the Madison Square Garden, he went on the canvas, and she was right there at the ringside. He later told me, when I looked at Edna's face, I jumped up and said, I got to knock this cat out.
The creases in his pants were so sharp, he bled. Sugar was the first guy who sort of blew it in the face of the white establishment. Hey, I'm great looking. I'm a killer with the ladies. I'm the greatest fighter in the world, and here's what I look like.
It was very rare for a black man at that time to be that sort of flamboyant and that stylish in a public way.
He would say to you, first there's God, and right behind God there's me.
I don't know all the answers, but I'm the greatest authority in the world on Sugar Ray Robinson, and I have some idea on just what he can do and what he can't do.
For all of his professed self-knowledge, Sugar Ray was not always in control of his emotions.
Ray Robinson was arguing with a woman one night, a woman that he probably wanted to bed. He had his hand raised as if to deliver an open-handed blow, and somebody grabbed his hand from the back, and this was not the thing to do with Ray Robinson. And he turned and was very angry until he saw it was Joe Louis. And Joe said, just leave her alone.
He was a man who, outside the ring, was as elusive to corner as he was in the ring. He always conned the newspaper men by calling them old buddy. I think in every town that he ever boxed, there's somebody going around saying, Sugar Ray Robinson used to call me old buddy.
Dad would have been a great politician. His persona was shallow. It didn't go deep. And if you went below the persona and hit a nerve, it was a problem.
He would be charming, pleasant, one minute and surly, and mean the next. He was on stage all the time. So nobody ever really knew the real Ray Robinson.
Sports Century's 50 Greatest Athletes is presented by GMC. Do one thing, do it well. Also brought to you by Budweiser. Now is the perfect time to enjoy a brewery fresh, beechwood aged Budweiser. By 1010-321, dial it and save 50% on calls over 10 minutes. And by Nike. After 85 straight amateur victories, 19-year-old Sugar Ray turned pro in 1940 as a welterweight and went undefeated in his first 40 bouts. At his camp in Greenwood Lake, New York, the atmosphere often reflected his manic nature.
He used to do crazy things in training camp. I remember him putting lizards and snakes in people's beds, and the guy would get ready to get in the bed and pull back this thing, and everybody would be at the door watching.
Ray ran 5 miles a day, walked 2 miles at night after dinner.
3 o'clock in the morning, you know, we'd get up in the room and shadow box.
He drank beef blood to strengthen him.
We had one of those old orange squeezers in camp that you crank up, and I'd put maybe 4 or 5 pieces of meat in there and put a glass in there, squeeze it down.
It also made him very nervous and temperamental, and you knew he was drinking blood.
Growing up in a Manhattan neighborhood called Hell's Kitchen, Ray discovered the seeds of his boxing brilliance in a local gym.
He was so great that he had to be handicapped by moving up in weight class to fight bigger guys. Otherwise, it was a performance and not a contest.
His very nickname, Ray Robinson, wasn't his name. It was Walker Smith, but he'd stolen somebody's card, so he became Ray Robinson.
When you're a young kid and you're black, and you see all the white people have everything, what do you think you're going to want? You want to reinvent yourself too, don't you?
He was a chameleon in that he would see something, and if it worked, he'd steal it.
Sugar Ray took charge inside and outside the ring. He began to book his own fights and negotiate his own contracts, even at some risk.
He got a phone call one afternoon, and the voice on the phone said, Ray, this is Mr. Gray. Well, Mr. Gray was Frankie Carbo, who was considered the underworld czar of boxing. Carbo wanted him to dump a fight.
Why not? Business. Robinson wouldn't go along with it.
Ray had too much pride to fix a fight.
The mobsters respected Robinson because of his style. they said, okay, that's fine. You know, there were no threats. He just said, just an idea, Ray, and that was the end of it.
He made his own decisions. I mean, he never confided anybody to say, should I do this or should I do that? He wouldn't take advice too well.
We're always hearing about boxers being taken advantage of. It was just the opposite where Sugar Ray Robinson was concerned.
He could break balls. He could use his power at the gate to really drive promoters crazy.
Ray was the first fighter to demand money from the theaters. He went to a theater and he saw clips from his fight. And he was furious. He says, you mean tell me they use this and I don't get paid? Put the lawyers on it immediately.
Hidden within Robinson's confident exterior was a fragile union of fear and anger. In 1947, the fear emerged in Cleveland the night before his first defense of the welterweight title.
Ray Robinson dreamed that he was going to kill a fighter named Jimmy Doyle with a single left hook.
And I got up that morning and I told the commission that I wasn't going to fight. And they said, why? And I told them what I had dreamed. It's all Ray knows. That's just a dream.
In the eighth round, Robinson dropped Doyle with a left hook. The challenger died in the hospital the next day.
His mother said he never recovered from that. He had an extreme amount of guilt and anguish.
Any sense of remorse or propriety in him was basically lost.
From that point forward, Robinson hated fighting. He hated what he was a genius at.
I've never enjoyed boxing. It's just a business with me, and I know I've never enjoyed it.
Just 3 months after winning the middleweight title in early 1951, a jubilant Robinson gathered his friends and hangers-on and took off for Europe.
It was like the triumphant tour of a king, with everybody attending to the king. I think the word entourage was created for Sugar Ray Robinson.
He had a masseur, he had a hairstylist, he had a golf professional.
The party ended that July in London. Robinson lost his crown to Englishman Randy Turpin in 15 rounds.
Ray had boxed in Paris, they'd lived in Paris. Robinson had Paris in his legs. Turpin was very awkward, hard to fight, lunged at you, moved the wrong way.
2 months later, Robinson regained the title, beating Turpin on a TKO in the 10th before 61,000 at the Polo Grounds. Emboldened, he reached for the next level, challenging Joey Maxim for the light heavyweight crown at Yankee Stadium in June of 1952.
He boxed that evening beautifully. Maxim never really landed a punch, but it was one of the hottest nights ever, ever. I think it was 106 degrees at ringside.
And Robinson collapsed. And because Maxim was the only guy standing in the ring, they gave him the decision.
The referee even passed out in that fight. Ruby Goldstein. Robinson was ahead on points when the fight ended, but he just burned himself out.
It was the heat that beat him. And I tell everybody, what did I do, have air conditioning in there?
He almost died, and that took a lot out of him. After the fight, he figured that he didn't want to fight anymore. He just wanted to do something different.
The loss to Maxim was the only knockout Sugar Ray would suffer in his career. 6 months later, he retired from the ring and began training for a life in show business.
A lot of my fans are wondering in regards to my intentions of boxing again. As yet, I have not made up my mind.
Put your head on my chest, and I'm Mr. Success.
If Ray hadn't made up his mind, the public certainly had, yet few would tell him.
There was always some promoter to promote him to think he could do these things, to be a great dancer, you know, a second Bojangles.
Do you want me to tell you the truth? I never heard one good word about his act. Everybody said he was sweet, he was likable, and nobody ever wanted to say a bad word about it. But privately, nobody thought he could really sing or really dance.
Back in Harlem, Ray's business empire was tumbling.
He was a hard-nosed business person in his fighting career, but in his other business career, you know, he was a softy. He trusted a lot of people to run his operations. They let taxes get behind, and they stole money.
And all of that came together to leave him bankrupt and forcing him to make this amazing comeback.
In desperate need of capital, Robinson re-entered the ring in early 1955 at age 33 and lost his first major fight to Tiger Jones. He then regained his timing later that year, knocking out the middleweight champ Bobo Olsen in the second round.
The first career was based on speed, grace, poise, but when he came back and had these hard fights, he won those fights on his chin.
In 1957, Robinson lost the title to slugger Gene Fulmer. 4 months later, with the press claiming he was through, Robinson took the title for a third time, dispatching Fulmer with what ring historians called the perfect punch.
And he hit me with this left hook that I never seen, heard, or felt. Matter of fact, when I got up, I said, how come Robinson's doing exercise between rounds? Look at him over there jumping up and down. He said, he just won. He said, they counted 10.
Robinson's next challenger was welterweight champ Carmen Basilio, an upstate New Yorker with a grudge.
This pink Cadillac pulls up. Sugar Ray Robinson and a group get out. I said, wait a minute, I want to meet this guy. I went up and I introduced myself to him. He gave me the biggest brush off. And I was hurt. I said to my wife, someday I'm going to fight that son of a bitch and kick his ass.
The winner and new middleweight champion of the world, Carmen Basilio.
In March of 1958, the 36-year-old Robinson met Basilio in a rematch.
I've polled 10 sports writers from around the nation here. 9 of them picked Sugar Ray to win by a knockout tonight. What's your answer to that?
9 of them are wrong.
The 11th round, they said I hit him with 24 or 34 straight punches. He came back out of that 12th round and he gave me a good shellacking. Although, you know, there was no love there. He had guts. He was not a quitter.
The winner and the new world's middleweight champion, Sugar Ray Robinson.
Robinson was now a 5-time middleweight champion. But despite earning millions with 141 victories, he was still caught in an endless network of financial woes.
Sugar Ray's entire purse was seized by the IRS. He got no money for one of the most savage fights in boxing history.
As his kingdom fell around him, Robinson's marriage to Edna May began to show signs of wear and tear.
He'd ask me, do you know if she loves me? I said, well, how would I know she loves you? Can't you tell if she loves you or not?
When I first witnessed my father hit my mother, it was like I didn't understand it. You know, I did not understand what was going on. It was a major shock to me.
He was broke. He needed money to live on. And he literally fought in Tijuana. He fought in Honolulu. He was losing more than he was winning.
He mentioned to me that he was getting tired. His training was hard. His legs weren't the same. When did you begin to feel it? I asked him, and he said, before I throw a punch, I never used to think about it. Now I have to think about it. So he knew.
In a 10-rounder against Joey Archer in November 1965, Ray no longer had to even think about it. Despite only his 19th loss in 24 years, he was done at age 44.
Archer, whose punch couldn't crack a potato chip, dropped Robinson. Miles Davis, the great jazz trumpeter and Ray's friend, went into the dressing room, tears rolling down his cheek, went over to Ray and said, Ray, you're packing it in. And Ray says, I know.
Ray's demise was sad and ungraceful. 201 fights. That's an awful toll to have to pay later in life.
It was the greatest defeat of my journalism career of more than 50 years because I could never get him out of the great denial. I could never get him to be the whole Ray Robinson.
When we return, battered and broke, Sugar Ray's final days are not so sweet.
SportsCentury's 50 Greatest Athletes is presented by GMC. Do one thing, do it well. Also brought to you by Wheaties, the breakfast of champions. By Burger King, where you can have the delicious King of Fries. Burger King, when you have it your way, it just tastes better. And by Lincoln Financial Group. Lincoln Financial Group, clear solutions in a complex world.
In December 1965, they held a Sugar Ray Robinson night in Madison Square Garden, a tribute from his fans, friends, and foes.
Four of his great opponents carried him around the ring: Randy Turpin, Bobo Olsen, Gene Fulmer, and Carmen Basilio. Basilio, who hated him more than everyone else, says to me, "You know, I offered the other three guys $100 apiece to drop him, but they wouldn't."
And then they gave him this huge trophy. He goes back to his apartment. The only furnishings in the whole apartment were a card table that was in the living room and the bed in their bedroom. And he put the trophy on the card table, and that's how it ended for him.
Robinson moved from New York City to California, where he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease in 1983. He began to slip ever deeper into isolation.
Frank Sinatra subsidized his existence. Frank Sinatra took royalty payments from Anheuser-Busch and signed them to Ray Robinson.
He was always still personable, but he wasn't champion of the world. He didn't have the crown on his head, so that was a big difference.
By 86, 87, he was a zombie. People who saw Ray at the end came away with tears in their eyes.
Ray died on April 12, 1989. He was 67.
Whenever he fought, the world had a way of standing still. The sin of the ring belonged to him.
I get goosebumps because this guy died not remembering his own history.
I say I'm the greatest heavyweight of all times, but pound for pound, I still say Sugar Ray Robinson was the greatest of all time.
I think what makes us so happy and joyous in seeing the young Cassius Clay is that we're basically seeing Sugar Ray Robinson reborn as a heavyweight.
Ali looked at the way that Sugar Ray boxed and said, can a big man move like this little man can move? Can I adapt what he did to what I do?
Greatest fighter, pound for pound, that ever lived. No question about it. I just wish a couple of close fights I had with him would have went my way. But he won fair and square. God bless him.
When you talk about the greatest of all time, okay, Ray Robinson and then who? Ray Robinson and then who?
The contention that Ray Robinson was the greatest fighter of all time was typically deflated by the counter-argument that he wouldn't fare well against a great heavyweight. Then somebody invented the phrase pound for pound, and instantly the case for Robinson gained muscle and merit. Sugar Ray is the evolutionary link between Joe Louis and Muhammad Ali. We will see you next week when the 50 greatest athletes of the 20th century continues its countdown with number 23.
This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com, a part of the Go Network. Go.com.